So, The Sunlit Man by Brandon Sanderson is the fourth and final novel in the Secret Project series. According to Brandon Sanderson, the first and the third one, Tressen of the Emerald Sea and Yumi and the Nightmare Painter, was dedicated to his wife. The second one was for him because he wanted to try something new. And the fourth one was for us, for fans of the Cosmere. And it's pretty obvious in the first few pages because we're introduced to our main character, who is obviously a world hopper. Now, it's very hard to recommend this book to people who haven't read, at the very least, the Stormlight Archive, because there are a lot of concepts in here that were introduced in the Stormlight Archive that it's sort of assumed in this book that you understand it. So, for example, investiture. If you haven't read the Stormlight Archive or any other books, you're just like, what is investiture? What does it mean to be invested? What is this this power that we use? Our main character from this book is from that series, from the Stormlight Archive. I'm not going to tell you who, but it's there are a lot of hints here and there of our character's identity. Now, it gets revealed later on, but by that time, if you have read the Stormlight Archive, you would have guessed it already, because it's not as obvious as I make it seem, but it's pretty easy to guess it. There are a lot of clues that makes us believe that this character was a Knight's Radiant, so from then on, it's very easy to sort of do a process of elimination and just be like, oh, that's probably that character. But this character is introduced by a different name. We call him Nomad. Now, if you don't know, if you haven't read the Stormlight Archive, Knights Radiant are basically paladins. So they have oaths. And each time they sort of power up, or each time they swear another oath related to their main faction. So for example, in like a classic paladin sense, there's oath of devotion, there's like oath of the ancients, there's oath of vengeance, or there are like different oaths, there are different factions. So Knights Radiant are kind of like that. So there are like different oaths that you could swear and different rules that you must follow once you swore that oath. And each time you get stronger, each time you swear another oath relating to that that basic idea of that faction, you gain abilities. So our main character is on the run from a mysterious group called the Knights Brigade. Now, our main character is clearly a powerful being, an invested being, at least enough to world hop. But our main character has an affliction. He has a very strange condition that prevents him from harming other people. So he has all the skills to like fight. He has the ability to just kill people. Actually, he's strong enough to basically like just fight and beat every single person in this planet that he is in, but he can't do that because he has this affliction he called the torment, where he just couldn't fight. He couldn't harm other people. Anytime he thinks of doing that, or anytime he tries to throw a punch, his body freezes up. And that is a very interesting affliction for our main character, because a lot of the fantasy books out there, fantasy stories where our main character is transported to another world, either they're like extremely weak and useless, and then like over time they get stronger and stronger, they gain abilities and improve their skills, or other times they're just like I don't know, just super strong, and then they help these people, these locals. We get a character who is extremely strong, who is extremely skilled, but can't use those skills in battle. We spend a considerable amount of time where the main character doesn't understand the people on this planet. He couldn't speak the local language. And that is not only hilarious, but also quite relatable. So if you've traveled and you go to a country where you don't speak the local language, it can be quite confusing. It can be quite terrifying. I love that we get introduced to this planet sort of the same way, with the same blindness that our main character has. So we don't see or we don't understand the locals as well. We're just like introduced to them and we're just like as clueless as the main character. And I love that feeling of this combobulation where it's that feeling of dread, you know, especially that our main character couldn't fight. So it's quite terrifying to be put in that situation. And I really appreciate that, that we don't just instantly get like a translator. So again, we're introduced to a very interesting and harsh world. So it's a world that is in constant change. The landscape, the environment is constantly changing due to a very harsh weather. So it's more the sun, really. The sun just melts everything. So it's a world where people constantly run away from the sun on a daily basis. And that is very interesting to me because it's sort of a reverse to your classic, let's run away from the darkness. Here, people are just like constantly chasing the darkness because that's where they're safe. That's where they won't melt. Well, that concept of the world that is in constant change, it's very interesting. I think what intrigued me the most is watching the locals, how they sort of try to adapt into that very harsh environment, because it's quite honestly, it's inhabitable. It can be frustrating at times to have a main character who is presented as someone who is like really, really strong, basically a divine soldier of God. And then he couldn't fight because he can't hurt other people. That's his curse. He's unable, physically unable to harm or commit violence. And it can be frustrating at times, but it's like, if he could fight, then this would have been like 10 pages. You know what I'm saying? So I did enjoy that part of that. I did enjoy that because it's him trying to figure out other ways to outsmart his opponents without actually triggering that curse, without actually making himself like lock up. Honestly, this just made me want to read the Stormlight Archive again because, dude, it just reminded me a lot of what I really enjoyed in the Stormlight Archive. And it really made me want to just read it again because I know, like, there are a lot of things that I missed in my first read through. Well, not a lot. There are a lot of subtle shit that I assume that I missed in my first read through, because it's like what, 1,000 pages per book. I know I'm gonna miss some shit. So if you haven't read Brandon Sanderson before, a lot of his magic systems, he explains it to you in detail, the science behind it, so it makes sense. I normally love that. I loved Navani's chapters in Rhythm of War. So it's a bunch of science stuff, and it's just her doing a lot of experiments and sciencey stuff about fabrials. Here, it was like, I didn't want to hear about it. So in Rhythm of War, there's a mix of the fantasy element and the sciencey stuff. So it's like, okay, this is magic, but let's explain it to you in science terms. Here, it's like, oh, this is how jet engines work. And I'm like, I don't care about jet engines. You know what I'm saying? So that was like the only part where I was just like, oh no, I don't want this. I don't want this much detail about jet engines. That was like the only part where I was just like, there's a little bit too much detail on jet engines. And that's me being nitpicky, by the way, because again, it's not that prominent, but I don't like learning about jet engines. I don't like learning about tech from these books, from fantasy books, at least. At least in Navani's side, in Rhythm of War, it's like, this is magic. This is fantasy. Let's use it in sciencey stuff. Here, it's just like, oh, well, this is how jet engines work. There's like no magic involved. Well, I guess like the power source is magical, but it's basically just like, oh, this is power, but it's a battery. So it's really not that involved. So it's just like you learning about jet engines for a few pages. So I'm like, ugh. Now there are also mentions here of Dawn Shards. If you don't know what a Dawn Shard is, go read the Stormlight Archive. Go read the Dawn Shard novella. It's pretty good with Lopin, because Lopin's in there. So that's really good. So if you have read at least Stormlight Archive 1, 2, you know that Lopin is like a really good character, Gancho. So that's pretty nice. So if you don't know, if you want to know what a Dawn Shard is, Dawn Shard is basically the will of God. It's a command of God? Is it the will of God or the command of God? Dude, I don't even... That's why I gotta reread Stormlight Archive. So basically, Dawn Shards is like what Sephandrius and them other dudes used to basically Adenalsium. And that's what it is. Now, in classic Sanderson fashion, there are a lot of moments here that would just hit you right in the jaw. There's something about the way this man composes words together to send like a particular message that just affects me so much that I'm just like, oh dude, why would you put it that way? Why would you make that scene like that? That is just, ah. Yeah, man. Again, there are a lot of moments in here, especially towards the end, where you're just like, whew. That's like a hit right in the jaw. And man, this, honestly, the writing style in here, it's very reminiscent of the Stormlight Archive. In the other three, those at least felt new and different. Like the tone is different in Tress of the Emerald Sea. The tone is different in Frugal Wizards, and that the writing as well is very different in Frugal Wizards. Yumi and the Nightmare Painter, it's also different from his usual writing style, like the voice that he uses. But here, this felt like Stormlight Archive. So I'm like, I don't even want to say that this is a standalone. I'm like, this might be like a Stormlight novel. It didn't feel like a standalone at all. And I wouldn't even recommend this to people who haven't read the Stormlight Archive, because I'm just like, they're like, you have like two other really, really good standalone novels in the Secret Projects, in Tress of the Emerald Sea and Yumi and the Nightmare Painter. So if you're looking for a standalone that you don't have to read like four gigantic books, read those. Those are really good, man. And it's still, both of those are still set in the Cosmere, although it's just a little bit more detached than this one, but it's still Cosmere. Although like he's using like a quite a different style or different voice than his usual. What is my favorite of the Secret Projects? Still Yumi and the Nightmare Painter. I just really love that. It's so different from like everything that he's written. It's just like different, you know? It's a lot more focused in the romance. And I don't particularly like romance, but it worked for me. And I also love that whole painting shtick that homeboy got going on. I love that, dude. I really love that. And the environment, the setting, the relationships between the characters. Again, it's not a perfect book. There are like parts in there where I talked about it in my video where I was just like, that wasn't as good, but it was like, it's fine. Dress of the Emerald Sea, it's just also amazing. It's probably the one where I would just reread it the most. More so than Yumi and a Nightmare Painter. Yumi and a Nightmare Painter is excellent to read. Like, it's excellent to read the first time or like anytime you want a romantic, I guess, book that is not as cringe as the other ones. It's still kind of cringe. There are like moments in there, but Tress of the Emerald Sea is something that I feel like I could read that every Christmas. You know, it's that kind of book where you're just like, oh, this is just like a feel-good adventure, fantasy, fairy tale. Or it's just nice to read. Yeah, man, that's pretty much it. I'll see you soon. Peace.